you can get a dialogue appointment setting and goblin from a consultation from a doctor in Bombay for as cheap as 150 to 200 rupees, and those two for online care. There's a single electronic medical record system which can then be accessed by the medical providers. So then it reduces a lot of redundancy from the system. Let's say somebody like get your urine test, right? And then you go to doctor number two. Doctor number two already knows what was done in the urine test by doctor number one and what the results were. So it reduces a lot of redundancy from the system and waste from the system. And as part of this marketplace, think of it like Hero for Telehealth. We give them the same technology that we use to manage our patients, the same electronic health record, which can work fully offline, the same practice management, the same analytics which we use. So we can tell each group what the health
administration is. If you go to most hospitals in India, today on the very well-run ones, they are not this scientific. And if you got a glimpse of how he is leveraging the cloud and how he is leveraging sensors, and as those become cheaper and become more accessible in India, I think Shelly and a few others like him in the country will lead the way in transforming.
And I'd just like to just add one comment last night. So, for example, hospitals know that they cannot deliver the value which we deliver better, cheaper, faster, or with more diagnostics than we can, right? So they actually outsource. Hospitals are our payers. They outsource to us their operations of their, like, you know, say health camps in community areas, right? Or their home care. And we do it on their behalf as their contractor under their branding, right? Similarly, I already mentioned CSRs are, like, you know, payers. Foundations are our payers. NGOs are our payers. Or NGOs are our resellers. So we would love to partner with, like, you know, other organizations who have a captive audience, where that organization might be delivering, say, education. Or like some, like, you know, something in that community, right? We would love to partner with them. They do mobilization and cash collection. We'll do the service and we can share the revenue. So there are lots of payers possible in this model.
I think one thing you might have noticed, Shelly is also very good at the other thing that entrepreneurs want to be good at. Thank you, Shelly. Prema. So Prema is, I think we had a short discussion during lunch, and she told me that she started off during one of these earthquakes, Maharashtra earthquake, if I'm not mistaken, and discovered that, you know, there's a lot more room for women to come to life and to be leaders in society when disasters happen. And based on that, she has built an extraordinary organization, and the numbers are there for you to see. 30,000 women entrepreneurs and 80,000 people who are employed, women who are employed. And if you understand Indian families, that means, you know, 80,000 women are now able to take care of children and send them for education, because it's often the woman who has to send the entire family, because either most dysfunctional families, either the man is drunk or violent and small. So the impact she's already having is extraordinary. So Prema, the question is, what is your vision? Where do you see yourself 3 years from now? And how do you want to get there?
Can I take the half minute to
created a movement of self-help groups that's
over 100,000 women, mainly Maharashtra, Gujarat and Tamil Nadu, and then Bihar. We are partnering with a lot of local organizations. What we've done is to shift from a development approach, which was grant-based. From 2007, we've created social enterprises that match our mission. The mission is to create large-scale livelihood and skill opportunities, especially for women.
Also, I think what's unique about our work and which we'd like to scale up is the ecosystem for entrepreneurs. It's, I think you can imagine it, kind of a sandbox. So we have the microfinance organization, which has financed more than 35,000 women to start and launch micro enterprises. We have the School of Entrepreneurship, which actually allows women to get trained in a more systematic way and also gain from mentoring services. And then we have the, we also provide the livelihood opportunity or the market access through a retail network company that we've begun. So these three actually act all together to look at the sectors I mentioned to you, water, health, sanitation. So we keep looking for opportunities in need sectors which match rural people and communities.
Thanks, Prema. So if you heard Prema very carefully, she's doing something that usual women entrepreneur networks have not done, which is not just train women to be entrepreneurs, not just turn them into entrepreneurs, but also build a market.
And we create, the women create the market. So currently that is happening in 2,500 village communities, providing the last mile access.
Right. And what's powerful about this, for those of you who think about scale, is there is this thing in computer science called the network effect. And each node you add to the network makes the network, you know, exponentially more powerful. And so at some point, Prema will reach this critical mass where the network will just explode, because every time an entrepreneur joins, they have access to this entire 2,500 village network. And every time a customer joins, they have access to this ethical group of women who are entrepreneurs. And the other thing you mentioned, Prema, is you're actually going to producers and asking them to build products for your market, which they would not have done otherwise. And so you're forcing actually FMCGs and others to think about your community as customers before they would just think about them as how do you push products. So I think all of those are very powerful.
We are partnering with about 13 companies, large and medium sized, in all of them are technology companies in the health, water, sanitation, clean energy, and also agriculture coming forward. So earlier the partnerships was merely to look at women as a channel, which is earlier done microcredit, so now they can deliver the goods. But the women turned around and said, look, these products are not acceptable in the rural market. So we are going to tell you what's happening here. And I think most companies have partnered, have sort of saved millions of dollars in R&D. But also we are looking at products which are actually suited and then customized in rural markets by the customers and the entrepreneurs.
Which is the heart of innovation. Thanks. So, go to the next panelist, Minot. If you talk to Minot, he will use words like mechatronics and sensors and electronics and automatic titration systems. You'll think he's building a rocket. But what he's building is a way to, you know, take organic waste and turn it into energy, but doing it at a much cheaper price, and also giving it sustainability, reducing OPEX, and doing all those things which have plagued this industry. I mean, those of you who grew up in India will remember that, at least people of my age will remember that people used to talk about gobar gas, you know, since 1970s, but it has never gone mainstream, and Mayanak is solving all those problems that are making it go mainstream. So Mayanak, the question is, what made you, I mean, one of the things that is missing in India is people who understand technology really well are not focused on problems that really matter, like the one you have chosen. Why is that? What got you, you know, focused on this very important problem? And from what you told me, you have installed something like 20 installations so far, which process food waste. And how do you go from 20 to 20,000?
Sure. Thanks. So yeah, I mean, coming to the first question, well, I'm an electronics engineer, worked for a few years in tech startups, but electronic startups, and then I did my MBA. MBA, lots of people abuse MBAs, but it does teach you a few good things. We are actually applying a lot of that out here. But yeah, I mean, post IIM Bangalore, I had two choices. I did have a great offer from a European consulting firm. I could have gone there. The other option was to do something more meaningful. What I felt was that if I had taken the other option, the next thing would have been my parents would have forced me to get married, and I think all these dreams would have gone for a toss, or they would have taken a back seat. So I thought that I just took the plunge, frankly. So I was working on some, actually some on some other idea while at IMB, but that did not work out really. So at the time of the conviction, I did not have an idea on hand. So I just thought that I'll give myself a year. A year should be a good enough time to figure out something. And the whole idea was I wanted to do something which had social and slash environmental impact, but a for-profit thing, which involved technology and all. For this, I teamed up with one of my seniors from IIM Bangalore. And again, when we started ideating, again, we had a completely clean state. We did not know what to do. We started thinking that let's look at what problems India faces. So it will become an ulcer someday, and you need to operate your body. The same has been happening with biogas in India for ages. The dropping of a pH, for instance, it's similar to that breakdown, and the system goes for a toss. Now, it's very easy to measure pH, that's the and which is the problem. So what we realized was that monitoring was a very big issue. These systems needed care, and we had to spend a lot of time. We had to go back to not just our electronics textbooks, but our chemical engineering, or other chemistry textbooks and all. So what we did was we defined the health of the system in a way which we could monitor, which we could automate. So coming back, like just cutting it short and coming to the presence today, so again, with respect to the scale-up story, we had a few milestones in place. The first thing was to have a solution in Bangalore which worked, and fortunately, our first guinea pig was Akshay Patra. We are like, we could not have found a better platform than them. Today, for the last 2 years, we have replaced the entire LPG needs of the Bangalore kitchen from the fuel that we generate from their very own waste. So that was the first point. So at that point, we did not really have our remote monitoring systems and all. The next stage was to kind of set up systems in locations further away from Bangalore and see if that worked. So now, having gone past that stage, today we are actually now planning to scale up. So with the rest of scale up, in our case, we see...
What's the most remote system you have?
So today we have plans in like just one system in Bhubaneswar or in Jaipur. We don't have any person out there. Again, when we're talking, if we had to add one person for monitoring the health, the OPEX would have gone for a toss. So sitting in Bangalore, we know what's happening. So it's like we have these early warning indicators. And the moment we see notice any issue, we just, our staff, they call the operator, who'd be a part of the housekeeping staff, and tell them that add this medicine, which is like a diegene. In our case, it would be some chemical, maybe sodium bicarbonate. The packets are just kept there. And as a part of the preventive maintenance check, which we do, we just replenish those levels. So the person out there operating it, they don't know. For them, it's just some labeled, colored medicine out there. So that's how the whole thing works. Now with respect to really scaling up, in our case, we see maybe two or three bottlenecks. One is, for instance, manufacturing. Now, it's a prefabricated solution. So again, we cannot really scale up by being a huge manufacturing company. So what we did was, from the very beginning, that's where the school supply chain textbooks came into play, 101 supply chain. So what we did was we split the system in such a way that the high lead time items, for instance, electronics, they take more time to build, but they are cheaper. So we segregated the design in such a way that we had a club of pieces which took higher time but cost lesser. And so what that meant was we could have done it build them in a made-to-stock fashion. As far as the bulkier pieces, like the Dabba, that anyone can do. In fact, also one point is that, as you can see here, it's a cuboidal digester. You talk to any biotech professor, they would scoff at that. They would say, like, this is a big mistake. Because normally when you look at any bioreactor, it's cylindrical. There are many multiple technical reasons for that. But the point is that it might bring in a little bit of inefficiency. But if I look at the economics of it, it does not really matter. But what is important is that anyone sitting in, let's say, a Ludhiana or a Bhilai, anyone can easily fabricate a keyboard and reactor. It is much, much more easier to fabricate as compared to a stainless steel cylindrical reactor. So today, for instance, we have a plant coming up for Akshay Patra, Lucknow. The system is being fabricated in Bhilai because to cut down on the cost, because it's for Akshay Patra, and you'd be shipping just the electronic pieces from here and assembling it within a week. So that was another part. So that's with respect to scalability in terms of manufacturing, so which we have already tackled. So tomorrow, if we have maybe 1,000 orders, we really feel that we can easily do that if we have the advanced knowledge. That's one part. The second is how do we, in terms of sales and marketing. So again, so today we are going to channel partners. Now to do that, yes, we have to find the right channel partners, train them and all. So that took some time, but today our channel partners, we have identified channel partners in key geographies and all, and they have started bringing the sales. So that's the other part, that's the way we feel we would be going forward. And the last part is, in our case, it has a certain capex. Now the point is that an Infosys, who is a client, or an Akshay Patra, or a Manipal University have the cash in their bank to buy our systems. It makes great economic sense. We talk of payback periods like 1.5 years or so. But the issue is that not everyone, hospitality industry, for instance, hotels, they have a high gestation period. So they cannot buy our systems upfront. So it's a no-brainer that going forward, we have to go to a standard ESCO model, a services model, which is seen in renewable energy space, as you see. So the idea would be we would be setting up the systems for free and just charging for the gas. Economically, we know that it's quite attractive. The question is that how we raise the capital. So yes, that is that inflection point where we are today. So the idea is that we want to raise a lot of $1 million, and yes, we genuinely believe it's a $1 billion story. But more than that, if we are able to do that, obviously to scale up, you have to earn money. But the objective which we started was to solve the problem. And if we are able to get that, we should have prevented thousands and thousands of tons from going to the landfills. And our aim is that by 2020, we should be mitigating more than 2 million tons of carbon dioxide equivalent greenhouse gases every year.
Cool. Thanks, Manoj. So what's powerful about Manoj? What's powerful about Manoj's innovation is that he's done two things. He's reduced the cost of this biodigester substantially, both CapEx and OpEx. And the other thing he has done is, usually the Western model for something like this, I was watching this National Geographic special, where outside New York, they build this massive facility which it burns something like 2,000 or 3,000 tons every day of garbage and turns it into energy, and it burns it at 4,000 degrees so that, you know, effluents are all clean and segregated and so on. And that plant costs, you know, $700 million. Now, that's a solution that will never work in India. And even if it would, vested interests would eat up some of that and all kinds of things would happen. And in many ways, unlike, you know, the China model, India is a do-it-yourself country. So he's creating, and the smallest size, he did not mention that the smallest size of his reactor is 100 kilograms of waste per day.
Yeah, 50 to 100.
50
yeah.
to 100 kilograms of waste per day. And it allows communities to kind of, you know, buy it, install it in their own community, get it going. And this technology is one of those things where once you cross volumes of a few thousand per year, the cost will start dropping dramatically. Because
In fact, just to add, today when we had to start off, we started off with stainless steel reactors and all. So going ahead, there are lots of research parts. One of the things is to now look at other material and all, bring down the cost of the digesters really. We know that does not really matter. We started off with stainless steel, but we are looking at the options how to bring down the cost.
Wonderful.
So the cost, it varies from around 8 lakhs to, it goes up to around 40 lakhs or so. But again, the pricing is such that the payback period is around 1.5 to 2 years. So from 1 ton of food waste, we generate around 70 kgs of LPG equivalent. So that's like 5 cylinders every day. So it makes a lot of economic sense. We generate almost twice the amount of energy as compared to conventional systems. And the more important point is that our plant uptimes have been 100%. Like, we have had zero plant downtimes. So it makes a lot of economic sense. So anyways, our idea is that we realize that we have to start selling the gas. So that's the way forward.
Thanks, Manoj. So Devi Prasad. So Devi Prasad is an entrepreneur who is trying to transform rural ecosystems, and he started with dairy. And what is essentially recognized is that tech transfer is a contact sport. That you can have textbooks about how self-help groups can do their own dairy and co-ops and so on, but they don't quite work because somebody's not there to help them, but he's taken it upon himself to help. And if that was not difficult enough, he's taken it upon himself to create a for-profit corporation around it so that he can scale. So I still find it hard to believe, Dev Prasad, that you can actually turn this into a even barely profitable, let alone profitable business. So how do you do that?
Well, first and foremost, thanks for the opportunity. It's very difficult to follow up what Mainak said, but I'll try. It's very difficult. At the starting, you said, you know, there's a lot of inspiration over here. I said there's more perspiration, you work hard, and you just keep looking for more opportunities. We started in 2009, and there's a small story behind that. Before I got into the dairying, I'm not from the dairy background, I'm not a dairy man. I'm basically an engineer who's in the banking sector, and I was an out-and-out for-profit commercial banker. In fact, I looked at CSR and NGOs and microfinance as that part of the bank that actually drained the profits away. That was till I joined a microfinance company where we did livelihood financing. And my job as a CFO was to close down all the unprofitable sides of the business. So I did that very effortlessly, you know, agarbattis, handicrafts, medical services. When we started with dairying, all the women were excited. They wanted a loan. And we did what a typical corporate would do. You draw up a checklist, you do weightages, you selected the 50 best borrowers that you had and gave them a loan. 6 months later, they were all back with their cows and they said, here's your loan. They didn't even say, here's your cow, here's your loan. And that's when, you know, it struck me saying, as Lalitesh said, there's a huge gap between what's in the textbook and what's in the reality in the ground. If you take a dairy textbook and you take a calculator, it looks really lovely, it looks sexy, it looks very profitable. But if you meet a dairy farmer, he's saying like, I want to get out, this is not happening. And that's because they face a lot of challenges on the ground. And that's when I started. For 8 months, I traveled across the country. I spent time in Behf, I spent time in villages before we came up with this idea of Arohana. The first thing we did was we formed the company and I said, let's create a model farm with 300 animals and we'll put state-of-the-art equipment and state-of-the-art animal husbandry practices. I went and pitched to all the investors that I knew. I knew a lot of people who are high net worth. Okay, sorry. So I knew a lot of people who are, you know, from high net worth families, and I pitched it to them, and everybody was excited. They said, yes, corporate farming is the way to go. And I had raised pledges for about something like 3 to 4 crores. And then I said, before I take the money, let me go visit the farms. And I went to large farm after large farm, and what I saw was terrible. It was scary. Animals were neglected, labor was disinterested, veterinary doctors were coming and going. They were supposed to have a certain amount of productivity. It was a fraction of that. The practical problems of the small farmer seemed to pale in comparison to what the large farms had. Every farm said, you know, we have to do integrated farming, processing, marketing. Then it works out for us. We can't do, you know, just one part of it. So I went back to my investors and I said, you know, this is not going to work. We have to do this as a social model. World across, out of the top 20 large dairy companies, about 16 of them are cooperatives or some version or variant of a co-op. So you have to do it, you know, by involving the masses. And all my investors disappeared. So we started with a small caucus. We started working in Tanjore. And we started learning more and more about the ecosystem. What were the things that the women needed to be more effective, to be more productive? There was skill building, there was training, there was veterinary services, fodder development. And all this had to come from the dairy business. Now, dairying is not a very huge margin business. It's something like 1.5% net margins after you cover all costs. So there isn't enough scope for all this. The government does some of it free. Some of the dairies do it by cross-subsidizing some part of their business from that. But what we found was that was really not the way to go. And that was when the Orissa government saw our work, and I had the good fortune of being showcased at Action for India, which is another Deshpande Foundation initiative. And at such a forum, you know, the Orissa government came forward and said, why don't you partner with us? We'll do a 10-year dairy development plan in one part of the district, one part of the state, where we've tried a number of times, but we don't have a company, a private sector player to come in and do the processing and marketing. So we last year signed a 10-year dairy development plan with them, and we started working with them. One of the other things that we did was, from our experience, we found skill building was a very big gap. So We tied up with the Agriculture Skill Council, and I'm very proud to say that we have the highest pass percentage amongst all their 50 partners. We took each one of these items and we started seeing where we could either hive it off or monetize it. We are right now partners at the Deshpande Foundation in the Hubli sandbox. We've come in only towards the end of November, where we are piloting a business where we will offer veterinary services, very similar to what Seva Mob is doing. But this is preventive healthcare, and it doesn't have the technology part as yet, because farmers are not accustomed to paying for any of these services. They get it completely free from the government, they get it subsidized by the dairies, and when we tell them you have to pay this cost, like, it's almost like scandalous. But we're just beginning to get there, we're not getting much resistance. Profitability, yes, it's a challenge, but I think this year, at least in two or three parts of the business, definitely we will see that.
Got it. Thanks a lot for that. So I think one of the things that you just heard from Devi Prasad and also from Vishwanath is the high contact and high touch innovations. You pretty much have no choice but eventually to use the third rail of India, which is both powerful and scary, which is the government. And you have to work with the government and find a way to work with them, find a way to excite parts of the government and make it happen. Otherwise, these high-touch innovations have a very hard time scaling. So,
I think about 2 years, 3 years back, when I met with Desh, he said something which made a lot of sense to us then. He said, when you have private companies, you have for-profit companies, commercial companies, you pitch to investors and you look at, you provide them with exit options, a strategic buyout or buyout by the promoters themselves or an IPO, that gets discussed very often. But when you're a for-profit social enterprise, you should build the business in such a way that you're looking for an exit through government. So your final exit, if it comes through the government, then the social enterprise by itself becomes very successful. Because the government can't deliver all services. They're struggling themselves. They have their own inefficiencies. There are vested interests in various different parts of the government. It's not like the government is one big homogeneous body. So if you can create that value, then there will be one part of the government which will want to come and work with you. So definitely, rather than looking at them as a partner, you should look at them as your final end customer.
Right. So,
can I ask a question? Have you tried that approach where the government is actually willing to take your technology and carry it forward?
So that happened in Orissa. We didn't go to Orissa, we didn't pitch. They called us and literally invited us over there. So it was, we went there and they asked us, okay, we've heard about these things that you're doing, we've seen these kind of things. Can you tell us what can you do in Orissa? So we did about 9 weeks of field study, and then we came back and we told them, there is this gap, but we can't fix it. There is this gap, but we can't fix it. There is this gap, but we can't fix it. We'll give you pro bono technical advice if you do these things for us. And they pretty much bought it.
Thank you. And last but not the least, Subhashish Patnaik.
We lead a organization called Gram Vikas.
So, healthcare was hard enough and livelihood and education was hard enough, you've taken on all of them. Now, the common mantra for entrepreneurs is focus, focus, focus. But instead of focusing on a particular vertical, you have taken a regional focus on. What led you to do that? And what are the advantages you're seeing and what are the disadvantages you're seeing? Because many people out here will be curious to learn whether is this a way that is more sustainable and more scalable than taking on a vertical approach?
Yeah. Thanks, Lalitesh. So when it's an interesting way you put the question about how do you go deep or broad? To be honest, let me answer it this way. What I'm trying to condense is a 36 year old. What I'm trying to condense is a 36 year old history. It was started 36 years back by Joe Manger. So what our approach has always been towards providing dignified solutions to the rural poor, and dignified and sustainable solutions. So, we are an NGO. So, our idea of development was always about holistic development. the biggest challenge is always about you know, breaking and getting the confidence of the communities you work with. Once you have the confidence of the communities, it is always easier to bring in other developmental areas. So when we talk about, you know, we are probably the best known for rural water and sanitation. So, and I mentioned water and sanitation because India, although we make a lot of noise right now, there's a lot of noise about people talking about sanitation. Nobody talks about water. And when we talk about, when you look at the sanitation in India, water is an integral part of the whole process. And we run the risk of, the danger of building another, a whole lot of toilets which are not going to be used and adopted. So the key, what we are trying to do, and what we have been trying to do, and we have been pretty successful in scaling up to a large extent, is the, the wash sector. What we have done in the wash sector, we have done what we are talking ODF for 100% of the people for around 1200 villages in Orissa, and piloted in 6 other states and 2 African countries. We have done social housing to the tune of, we are in the currently doing, for you would have heard of, Orissa is a disaster prone area, so we have done social housing for 20,000 impacted households. So all these when we are talking about, we run 4 schools. So when we are talking about scale, yes, there is scale. Yes, we have knowingly focused on certain communities. It's not that we do not want to spread. We also understand that India is also almost like a country with many countries. Each regional nuance is very different. So we understand that the scaling part is very important. It is very important to have like-minded partners where you can form a network of partners. That is something which you are working on. And also one of the important things that has been mentioned, we believe in the developmental efforts which are being done. Government is an integral part. There are tons and tons of money which is available by the government, and if we as an mechanism via us or our network of partners, we can access those funds. I think that, and our mantra module, which we call the Movement for Action Network and Transformation of Rural areas, is around transformation.
The biggest cost that, for example, we have is manpower cost. It's not the pedagogy is there, the product development happens, but delivering it is still a huge task, because government school teachers or even affordable private school teachers is a tough thing. So, can you just elaborate on that aspect?
So, this is not a new project. There used to be this project in the previous administration called NOFN, National Optical Fiber Network, and some of you have heard of it. And unfortunately, National Optical Fiber Network, even though it was an ambitious project, it was incomplete from a network designer's point of view. It was incomplete because it dropped a 100 megabit per second connection to every panchayat, and that's simply not enough, and it does not reach everybody's home. And it also started at the district or the block level, which is in the mandal level in South Indian terms. And that's not enough, because the national backbone does not reach the mandal or the block level. So, when the new CM of Andhra, Chandrababu Naidu, who is known to be tech savvy, he became a chief minister, he declared that one of the things he wants to build is a fiber grid. And even though I grew up in Bombay, for some reason they think that I am from Andhra Pradesh, because my parents are. So they called me and I said, if you want help, I'm happy to help. And designed this new way of, building a fiber grid, which will economically allow us to have a sustaining network where 10 megabits per second can be delivered to every home for 120 rupees to 150 rupees per month. And the reason why 120 rupees is that magic number, is that happens to be the ARPU, the average revenue per user, for telephone users. So that is a sustainable price point which the average Indian can afford, as has been demonstrated. And the reason why 10 megabits, it's not because we want everybody to want Netflix or video, but the reason is that the average Indian is not educated, and the ones who are educated are barely literate. So they will, the first way they will consume information, and many of the services you heard here, is via video. They're not going to read pages of text. So So one way of thinking about it is that every 10 years of your education decreases your bandwidth need by a factor of 10. Even though you consume more bandwidth because you're doing more and more, but for the same task, you will need far less bandwidth than you would had you not had that education. So we are working on that. It's still in the early stages. It caught the fancy of the central government. So Mr. Ravi Shankar Prasad's team got very interested in what we are doing, and we are trying to see if the national effort, NOFN, can also be transformed into this, because they are pushing for, you know, what you have heard called Digital India, and Digital India cannot come to life with the bandwidth infrastructure we have today. So I don't know if that answers your question.
Can I come make a comment? I was at the Digital India Summit last week in Delhi.
Yeah.
There was a presentation by CDOT.
Yes.
It seems they have done something where the transmitter will be at the Gram Panchayat level, and each village can get a lot, at total cost. So if 8,000 people can get at 4 lakhs, you can divide it to extra 50 rupees or something like that. Do you have any comment on whether that CDOT technology is working or workable?
I have not
and
seen
that.
The
that's not optical fiber.
Yeah.
It is through line of sight.
Yeah. I have not seen the technology, but since it's using RF, you said it transmits 10 megabits per second, right? The problem is you need 10 megabits per second into every home. So a village will need a gigabit per second. And many reasons why internet has not really penetrated the mainstream of the country is because 256 kbps is not enough. Because you don't have to think too far. You just have to think about, you know, your 3-year-old or 5-year-old sons, nephews, grandsons and so on, and granddaughters. They will consume the internet if you give it to them on video. They will not consume the internet if you give it to them on text. However, they will move to text, assuming they are in a well-educated family. They will move to text within 10 to 15 years. But I have a 12-year-old daughter, and she's just starting to move to text. A 9-year-old is still happy with video, even though he can read. So there is this transition that happens where you get an emotional endorphin rush out of reading, which takes around the 8th or 9th grade, and very few people in India have had high quality 8th grade level education. And until the transition happens, their consumption is going to be on video in a local language. And that's the reason why we need to build a fiber grid. And in many ways, it's actually not that expensive. The proposal that we have gets fiber to every home at less than $20 per person. And in the scale of infrastructure, compared to roads and other infrastructure, this has far higher ROI. And the per capita cost is not that high.
If I can continue, I work in villages with internet, and one of the most serious problems we have is, even when the optical fiber is put, somebody digs it up and it breaks down for months together. So optical fiber is not probably the correct solution, with due respect to your fiber architecture. So I think we need to have something that is not diggable.
So we are doing two things on that front. I will stop with that. And this is a problem that is very well known. I used to work at Google, and I'm aware of how data centers optical fiber gets cut. So you are building a loop configuration instead of a tree configuration. So a single cut does not take it down. And the other thing we are doing is we are building it 1.6 meters deep, which is well below the digging capacity of most diggers. So manual diggers cannot get there. Only backhoes can. And backhoe, you know, the big cuts are everywhere. But I don't want to start the conversation with this one. We will open up the questions for audience. And we had a few questions.
I just want to go from Sumail. So you have a very efficient technology. And I just want to know, because Bangalore is facing a lot of problems here, solid waste management. And did you talk with the government of Karnataka, and what is your experience?
Yeah, I mean,
the government of Karnataka is interested in taking up.
We tried, but you know how BBMP is. I mean, it's like a black hole of time. So, for that matter, no. Unfortunately, no. I mean, the way it works. We have got, despite being a company registered in Karnataka, we have not received any support. In contrast, Chennai Corporation has been very supportive. So we are doing some stuff there.
This is the high time, actually. I think you must educate our policymakers or the politicians so that they take up this problem.
All the towns in Karnataka, throughout India, they have this
problem, actually.
So of course, we want to go there, but without taking too much time. But again, our idea was that, again, from a scalability perspective, time is expensive. We do not want to waste too much time. Already, if we can solve the problem for bulk-based generators,
there are so, we would have taken care of a huge amount of waste. So that's the way we're looking at it. But yes, having said that, we are gradually talking to corporations. Chennai is happening. Pune has been, corporation have been supportive. So it's happening, but unfortunately the tendering process, L1, that it becomes very tough for startups to get into that space. And when you have the waste mafia and all, it's really tough to, that's the way it is.
You'll be solving two problems. Actually, it can be methane. You will be capturing the methane. It's very important.
That's what, getting into bigger scale, it has its own set of problems. So what you feel is that decentralized, we can do it even in a decentralized way. The point is that for that the right technology has to be there, and that is what we have been working towards.
And we have climate change action plans at the center.
So I agree with your sentiment, but the problem is that the reality on the ground is that we have a Teamsters-like situation where there is a mafia which is very closely allied with the political hierarchy. And what Mynak is doing is actually strategically very sound. If you look at the breakdown, 40 to 50% of the city's waste comes from the bulk waste producers. And if you go after a significant chunk of the bulk waste producers, he's been very humble about it, but he will not just be $1 billion company, he'll be a $10 billion company. And when that happens, he will have more power than the mafia, then he will take action.
Hi, Lalitesh, and Ketan, I think, for Fuel. I have been mentoring Fuel for the last 6 years in Deshpande Foundation and as a part of Thai Hubli president and other stuff. The question is, right now it's a very physical model where each village he goes, does the seminars, does the tests and kind of counseling and other stuff. Since I see you are from ex-Google head products and other stuff, how can technology play a role in reaching the mission what he has to about 1 crore, that is 10 million kids counseling? And that 10 Mbps is very exciting. I'm just thinking about taking it to Andhra now. I think the technology is something which we are trying to do it, and we're working on this model. We need support from technocrats to scale our initiatives to do online counseling, and a lot of corporate volunteers want to help us. So I'll just end on note that we need technology to reach to grassroots innovations, and it's very important for all of us. So if there could be any ways where technology can be collaborated for all of our efforts, it would be really interesting.
We have been hearing the story that every village is going to be connected with high-speed internet for quite a while. The skepticism is something that is quite justified in terms of, what that timeline is going to be.
So I think it's a question of willpower, right? And I'm hoping this particular combination of center and state government, not just AP, but there's also the Chhattisgarh government and the MP government, which are very forward looking. And I think one of them is hungry enough to make this happen, so we will see. The thing that has changed in the last 5 years, Vishwanath, is that, I spent the last 2 years going to various villages across India. And there was a dramatic shift that I noticed in the last 24 months, which is people have realized that the internet and technology is something that will give them a leg up. They don't know why it will give them a leg up, they intuitively come up to the conclusion that it will. And that has created a political force which was not there before. So if you saw why, the UP government, even though they did not do it, announced they 1 laptop per child and so on and so forth, even though they did not deliver. The reason they did that is they noticed that there is a political swing if you make these promises. At some point, you have to keep on all these promises. And to answer your question, Ketan, so one of the ways that information, I believe, and to answer your question, one of the ways that information, I believe, will be built for the next billion people is not by being built for the next billion people, it is built by the next billion people for themselves. And the backdrop here is one of the innovations I had built, which was called MapMaker. And maps for the, if you look at Google Maps, the maps for 180 countries, including India, all entire developing world, were built on top of this platform. And Google did not build them, nor did Google pay people to build them. These were built because they simply launched a platform with something called a trust system and various other algorithmic innovations like machine learning and so on. and unleashed and allowed everybody in the world who wanted to draw on the canvas of the world and draw maps. If you look at this picture, every white patch you see is a network of roads, and each of those roads has been drawn by some user with their bare hands. And 180 countries were mapped this way, and the impact has obviously been enormous. We did not anticipate the kind of impact it would have. The UN used this in about 200 disaster interventions and disaster relief. In Pakistan alone, when Pakistan got flooded in 2010, the UN asked for our maps and said that we were able to save 800,000 more people, and 250,000 of them, according to their statistics, would have not survived had it not been for these maps, which astonished the US government when we described this to General Petraeus, who was in Afghanistan at that time. He said, but we have maps of Pakistan, we're all over Pakistan. What do you mean we didn't have maps of Pakistan? And then we described that interior parts where there is no strife is where the floods were the worst. And in those interior parts, nobody cared, right? Because there was no development, there's no development, there's no military. Nobody cared about mapping those areas. But the users care, and that's the point I'm making. One of the points that Desh makes is very often engineers and smart techies build solutions thinking they know what the solution is. What I learned is you build a platform and let users build what they want to do on top of it, and then it's more likely to succeed. So to answer your question, we are going to build crowdsourcing platforms, not just me, but others are. And those platforms is how you will bring the information that you and yours.
I'd just like to bring back the discussion to the social innovation and scaling it up. And I think what I'd like to debate on here is when we've chosen women as the last mile entrepreneurs, what we have been finding is that the focus on inclusion, which is a must for us going forward, is not part of what is spoken generally in the social entrepreneurship session. By that I mean that addressing the gender barriers that women face, addressing the social and cultural barriers, but also looking at how can we create jobs, skills and entrepreneurship in the rural areas is really part of scaling up the model itself for us. And I think this poses quite a bit of challenge. Right now we do have a hybrid model where the business part of it is that we have a network of more than 2,000 entrepreneurs, and they are earning at the rate of more than their earnings it's a fairly minimum. It goes from 2,000 to 5,000 rupees a month, which means that at least 2 crores of income is generated. They're reaching out to more than 1 million people in a year, which I think potentially if we do get the partnership that we are seeking with government, we could potentially scale up. But what I'm trying to make a point here is that social enterprises in the space currently in the bottom of the pyramid cannot really scale up, because on one hand the demand for the products is really linked to behavior change, and that needs to be created and invested. Currently, for example, the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, that is a great opportunity because the government would create the opportunity or the demand, so to say, for sanitation. But otherwise, it comes upon the social enterprise to create a huge demand so that it can scale up. And the other part, which is the ecosystem which is required to create the impact, which is finance, skills, access to markets and technology, is what again is the job of the social enterprise, not something which is mainstream. And I think for the question on 10x scaling, my wish list would be is to see that on one hand we are seeing that the government through the livelihoods mission is going to provide business credit at the last mile, which will be, you know, as low as 4 to 5%, in which case all the communities and the consumers we are talking about will actually have the purchasing power to improve the quality of their lives, whether it's healthcare, whether it's insurance or energy and so on. But otherwise, the what we are looking at is that, you know, finance on that scale in order to scale up 10x is really missing. So we are looking at finance which is not available for the entrepreneurs or for the consumers.
So I think we are already over time, and we will move to close. And I would like to say that, you know, unless there are any last burning questions, I'd like to say that very grateful to have been on this panel, and the panelists, both young and senior ones, are. I said that. I didn't say that. Are blazing a trail in each of their own paths, some at the beginning stages and some, you know, to the point at the cusp of massive scale. Some of them you'll be hearing about in newspapers, you know, 2 to 3 years from now, probably in national newspapers. And I would like to say that, you know, they're all, we didn't get a chance, but there are also people in this audience, like Dr. Jim and others who have built organizations of massive scale in India. And it is, in many ways, the dialogue, the development dialogue community, is a bunch of doers. There are very few people who are thinkers. People here, who come here, are people who do, and people here are entrepreneurial, and people here have this, you know, instinctive gene of empowering the local leaders to, you know, drive their own community. And those three ingredients, I have learned by watching the Deshpande sandbox and watching other successful innovations around the world, seem to, you know, be the three ingredients which will lend to massive scale. So with that, I'll close, and I want to thank all of you for being here, and thank all of you for coming.